Hey guys, Dr. Cadell, and this lab is determining the molar mass of an unknown carbonate using the ideal gas law. So first of all, unknown carbonate, what does that mean? It means that it's an ionic compound and the anion is carbonate, CO3 2-, that part right there. What's unknown about it is the identity of the cation, here, X just stands for whatever it could be. And because we don't know what the cation is, we don't know what the molar mass is. So that's what we're going to find out, is the molar mass of your unknown carbonate. So let's talk about molar mass, right? Molar mass, it's grams per mole. It's how many grams we have in a mole of that compound. So what that means, if you think about that, is that in order to determine the molar mass, we need two numbers. We need to know how much it weighs and how many moles we have. Well, top part's easy. We're going to weigh our unknown carbonate, and that gives us the grams. All the rest of the experiment is to get this part right here, the moles. And here's where the ideal gas law comes in. That we're going to take the unknown carbonate and react it with hydrochloric acid. And whenever you react any carbonate with an acid, the reaction looks something like these two equations down here. So the way that we're going to find how many moles of our unknown carbonate we have is by reacting the unknown carbonate with hydrochloric acid. Now, if the cation in the carbonate has a +1 charge, the formula is going to look like this. Two of the cations with one carbonate, because remember, carbonate has a -2 charge. However, if the cation has a +2 charge, it'll look like this, only one with a +2 and a -2 here. But it doesn't really matter here, because in the balanced equation that describes the reaction of either of these carbonates with an acid, hydrochloric acid in this case, we always produce a 1-to-1 mole ratio of carbon dioxide gas to our unknown. The idea being, remember, our goal is to find moles of our unknown. Because it's a 1-to-1 mole ratio between the carbon dioxide gas that's given off and our unknown, if we can somehow figure out how many moles of carbon dioxide gas are given off, we know how many moles of our unknown we have, and we have the denominator in our equation, and we're good to go. The whole setup that we're going to use today is aimed at determining how many moles of carbon dioxide gas are given off. It gets a little bit complicated, guys, because when the reaction occurs in an aqueous solution, and the carbon dioxide gas is given off is produced inside of that solution. And it ends up that some, not much, but some of that carbon dioxide gas is absorbed, is dissolved in the water, in the solution, and it stays there. Some of it goes up above the solution, and we're going to measure that in the gas form. But we really want to know how much carbon dioxide gas is given off. So if we go over here and look at this picture, so to find out how many moles of carbon dioxide are produced in this reaction, like I was saying a minute ago, it's going to end up in a couple of places. If this is the container that the reaction occurs in, this is the aqueous solution down here. Some of that carbon dioxide gas gets dissolved in the water. And so we have to take that into account to be as accurate as we can. Some of the carbon dioxide gas, most of it actually, ends up above the container. And I'll explain how we're going to measure that. But we're going to measure what we need to find out how many moles we have of carbon dioxide gas up here. What we need to measure, if we look at this equation right here, the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT, our goal is to find moles of carbon dioxide gas, and this is in the gas phase. That's equal to the pressure times the volume over the gas constant R times the temperature. What that tells us, if we can measure these three variables, P, V, and T, it's easy to calculate how many moles of carbon dioxide are in the gas phase. That's how we're going to do that. And when we do the experimental setup, I'll show you how we're going to get those three variables experimentally. Now down here, we're going to be able to calculate how many moles of carbon dioxide gas are in the solution. We're going to need to know a couple more things. It ends up we're going to need to know the mass of the hydrochloric acid solution that we add to here. So we're going to weigh it. And we're going to also need to know the molarity of the hydrochloric acid. That's something that's going to be given to you. Matt standardizes the hydrochloric acid, and we'll give you that number. But once we know that, we'll know everything we need to calculate the number of moles of the carbon dioxide gas, as well as in solution. That'll give us the moles of our unknown, because it's a one-to-one moles ratio. We know everything we need for the molar mass. That's all there is to it. So why don't we go over here and get started on the experiment. First thing we're going to do is going to give us the top half of the molar mass equation, the mass. So we're going to take our unknown, and as always, with an unknown number, we're going to take it off. We're going to record that in our data table, as well as our conclusion. So you're going to do this three times. Each time you're going to weigh about 1.25 grams, around that, of your unknown into a cuvette. So we're going to put the cuvette on the balance, tear the balance. So now it says zero with the cuvette on there. Take it out because we never add anything on the balance directly. Just pour some in until we get about, you know, roughly 1.25 grams. But we do need to know how much it weighs. Two, three places past the decimal. Pretty close. Thing is, we don't want to go much above 1.25 grams, and I'll show you why when we get to that portion. All right, so once we have that mass, record that in our data table. Remember, you're going to do three of these, so there's going to be three different masses. Take that and set that aside. Now we're going to set up our apparatus. The way it's going to work is you're going to have a quart-sized mason jar, and I've already filled that all the way up with tap water. A pint-sized mason jar. Each of these mason jars comes with a lid already set up. The quart-sized mason jar has two pieces of glass tubing in the lid. The pint size has one piece of glass tubing. What we're going to do now is we have two gaskets. We want to make sure that we have one gasket and one gasket only in each side of each lid. So we'll pop those guys in there. And now we're going to attach the tubing. We have also two pieces of rubber tubing. Now to put these on, if we don't put these on securely, there's enough pressure inside this system to where they can pop off and then stuff goes everywhere. So we want to make sure they're on there pretty well. So what we do is we take the rubber tubing, dip it in some water, and we're going to put one on each of these pieces of glass tubing that's on the that's going into the quart-sized mason jar. Now, this step right here, guys, if we get this thing hooked up incorrectly, the whole setup doesn't work. The crucial thing is that if you look at these pieces of glass tubing down here, one's shorter than the other. One does not go down as far beneath the lid as the other one does. The one that does not go down as far, the short one, that's the one that connects to the pint-sized mason jar. Short to short. So if I take this guy, dip this in the end in the water, pop it on here. All right, now that's good. The other end, this is going to end up going over into the 600 milliliter beaker that you have. We're going to put a short piece of glass tubing on that. So we dip this in the water, pop that in there. Now the tubing's all connected. The next step, so it ends up, you guys, that we need to fill this piece of rubber tubing up with water. And to do that, before we start the reaction, Matt's going to come over here and give me a hand. What he's going to do is Matt's going to take this pipette bulb, and he's going to push air through this piece of rubber tubing. And what's going to happen when he does that is basically the same thing that happens from the reaction. Push air through this piece of tubing. It's going to press on the water. Now, the water's going to try to go somewhere where there's not as much pressure pushing back. And the only place that is at the bottom of this long piece of glass tubing inside the mason jar. So what's going to happen is water's going to come up through there and fill this guy up. So Matt's ready. He can start pushing. And as the water's going to come out, I'm going to close off this piece of tubing with this pinch clamp right here, right above where the glass tubing ends. There it is. So if you notice, what Matt does is he keeps that pressed and he pulls it off. He does not release it while it's still on there, because if he did, he would pull water back up through this system. So now, okay, thank you, Matt.
You're welcome.
We've pushed some water out of here. We went up, and we also have some water over in here. So the way this whole setup works is the chemical reaction is going to occur over here, and the carbon dioxide gas that gets produced is going to come up, most of it, the one that's the stuff that's not dissolved in here, is going to come up through here. It's going to press on the water just like the air did from the pipette bulb and collect over here. Now remember, there's three things that we need to measure about the carbon dioxide gas to use the ideal gas law: pressure, volume, and temperature. What this does is it gets us the volume, and here's how. We're going to assume, and it's a very good assumption, that the volume of gas that's produced here is equal to the volume of water that's displaced from the central jar. So we're going to measure the volume of the water using this graduated cylinder and use that as the volume of the gas, and it works really quite well. The other thing we need is the pressure and the temperature. To get the temperature, we're going to measure the temperature of this solution. We're going to assume that the temperature is the same as the temperature of the gas. It's a pretty good assumption. And then we're going to measure the atmospheric pressure out there. And those will be the three things that we need. But because there's some water in here and we're going to measure the volume of water that's produced, we don't want to include that water in our measurement because carbon dioxide gas from the reaction did not produce this water. So we pour it back in here. And by the way, this is also the reason why we want to make sure we don't add too much over 1.25 grams of the unknown, because the more unknown there is over here, the more carbon dioxide there is that's given off, and the more water that's pushed out. If we have too much of our unknown carbonate, then we're going to run out of water, and then there's going to be gas that's being given off, no water being pushed over, and our volume measurement would be inaccurate. So now here, okay, I've got the water back in that quart size mason jar. This point, I want to make sure that this lid is on securely, double check, make sure the gas gets in there. If this is not on securely, we'll get a leak. And then once more, carbon dioxide gas is being released that's not pushing water over, and our volume measurement would be inaccurate. There. So now, the unknown, I'm just going to place it still in the cuvette over here. The last piece to this experiment is the hydrochloric acid. So in order to calculate how much carbon dioxide gas ends up in the solution, we're going to need to know the mass and the molarity of the hydrochloric acid. So we'll give you the molarity. Matt has it standardized. He has it on the bottle right there. To measure the mass, we're going to take a 150 milliliter beaker, put it on the balance, tear it. We're going to use a volumetric pipette to measure 25 milliliters of the acid over into there. So we don't want to actually put the volumetric pipette in the reagent jar because then we could contaminate it. So I'm going to pour some out and transfer it from there. Volumetric pipette, we've used these before. Where's my line? Matt likes to give me pipettes without lines on them. I'm messing my head. I found it somewhere. There we go. Are you moving it so I can see the thing? So that's the mass of our hydrochloric acid. Record that in our data table. I'm going to take that acid, and as soon as this acid touches the carbonate, it reacts just like that. So that's why we have the carbonate still in the cuvette, to keep the hydrochloric acid separate from the unknown. So I'm going to pour the acid in, being really careful not to get any on the unknown that's in the cuvette. All right, so now that we have the hydrochloric acid solution in the vessel with the unknown carbonate, we're going to make sure we have the gasket on here again. We want to get this lid on tightly. We don't want any leaks. Pretty good. At this point, we can release the pinch clamp. We want to make absolutely sure that we hold on to this. This comes out with enough pressure that it can shoot out and spray everywhere if we're not careful. So here we go. Now we're done. Stopped reacting in here, no more water's coming out. So what we're gonna do here is pinch this off so that we don't have to push water through for the next run. So there's still water in here. And immediately record the temperature in this, of the solution here, because that's gonna be the same as the temperature of the carbon dioxide. So record this glass thermometer. Once we get that, we're gonna put that in the data table. We're going to go right out and immediately record the atmospheric pressure on the barometer out there. When we're reading the atmospheric pressure from this barometer right here, there are two scales. The outer scale is in millibars. The inner scale is in inches of mercury. We will use inches of mercury, the inner scale. The needle that points to the atmospheric pressure, the end we read is the narrow end, the top end right here. And the next thing is that if you look at the closest marks on the inches of mercury scale, they're 0.02 inches of mercury apart, which means that the best we can do when we read this is measure this pressure to the hundredths place, to pass the decimal. The reason that we wanted to measure the pressure, the atmospheric pressure on the barometer, is that the carbon dioxide gas that's in here, the gas that pushed over the water, it's in here with water molecules in the vapor phase also. The atmospheric pressure, because this is open to the atmosphere, is the same as the pressure inside of here. The total pressure in here is equal to the pressure of the carbon dioxide plus the vapor pressure of the water. You're going to read the vapor pressure of the water off the table that's in your lab and subtract that from the total pressure, which you read from the barometer. The difference gives you the pressure of the carbon dioxide gas, which is what you need for the ideal gas law. And the last measurement we need is the volume of the water that got pushed over, because that'll be the same as the volume of the gas that pushed it over. So we take this 500 milliliter graduated cylinder, pour all the water in there. Now, a couple things about reading this graduated cylinder. For most of these graduated cylinders like this, there's two scales. One that starts with zero at the bottom, 500 at the top. The other, zero at the top, 500 at the bottom. We want to read the one that starts with zero at the bottom. The next thing is the closest marks are 5 milliliters apart. That means we can only read this to the ones place, not the tenths place. We need to read that and record that number in our data table. That's everything we need for the first run. We're going to do that run, do two more runs, and we'll finish the experiment.